thank you, Mr. Butler, for being here with us in the offices of the web portal and newspaper Ploštad of Kumanovo. We are really glad to have you here today.
Ivan, it's my pleasure to be here, and it's also I wish you a second praznik. This is the day of Kumanovo.
Thank you, thank you. It's really great to have you here. It's been 10 years since you left Macedonia, almost 10 years. How does it feel to be back?
In many ways, it feels like a long time, but it also feels like I left yesterday. I got off the airplane, and I knew the people in customs and the passport control already, like, okay, you know, some things haven't changed. They're still my friends.
Oh, amazing. And how do you see Macedonia changing in the last 10 years? I mean, you were with us in very challenging and very interesting times, and now 10 years from that, where are we? How do you see it?
Well, what put a smile on my face when I got off the air? I've come back a couple of times on very short visits, which were focused on national security, international security issues, so my mind was in a different place. But I felt relaxed, and I felt relaxed because the people around me were relaxed. Back when I arrived in January of 2002, first off, there was this fog. Literally, I was one of the few people who landed in Skopje that month. The fog was that bad, and I've never seen people so tense, so worried. And I don't feel that today. Mm-hmm. I feel there's a different kind of worry. It's more of how are we going to build this country into the future, not how are we going to save it.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm guessing that in those short visits you hadn't had the chance to come to Kumanovo, and I know that as ambassador you visited Kumanovo in the period of 2002 to 2005. How do you see it today? Has it changed a lot?
It's changed. It's changed in the right way. You know, the changes are not dramatic. You know, there aren't new boulevards, there aren't giant new buildings. You do see that in some places I've been where I wonder where that came from. And I don't even recognize this place anymore. But I recognized immediately, but I could also see slow evolution in a positive way. And that made me smile.
Well, slow evolution in a positive way sounds quite encouraging, I must say.
Because it's sustainable. Sometimes you grow too fast or change too fast, it doesn't last very long, mm-hmm. or it really doesn't fit the character of the people. Mm-hmm. And Kumanovo still feels like a place where people are still Kumanovci first, you know, working towards the future and not worried about the past.
Well, that's great to hear. And as an expert in international security, I'd like to ask you, how do you feel we're on our way towards NATO? I mean, are we getting there? When do you see Macedonia as becoming part of NATO?
You may not like the answer very much, but in many ways, Macedonia is already part of NATO. You're not officially a member. Mm-hmm. The joke I make is Macedonia is a member of NATO except in name. There's a little bit of a pun on that one. And the reason why I say that is I spent 1 year in Iraq. On my first day on the military base where I worked, I went to the dining facility. I walked up to the counter of my tray and there were 1,000 soldiers in line with me. And there were two men on the other side of the counter who were serving the food. And I heard, "Ambassadore." And they were men from Kumanovo who recognized me, and I was home. Now, that wasn't a NATO mission. At that point, it wasn't a NATO mission. But I had a chill in my body that these guys are already part of us, working with us. And that made me feel very comfortable. So that's kind of where I see Macedonia is. You're finding your way despite the obstacles that prevent you from becoming a formal member.
Yeah, well, hopefully in the near future we will get to the name of a formal member of NATO. Tell me, one of the impressions that a lot of Macedonians have around here and that I've heard over and over again is that the Bush administration was particularly friendly towards our country, and that the foreign policy of the time was exceptionally pro-Macedonian, if I may call it that way. We are today, this month, celebrating 10 years since the United States recognized Macedonia under our constitutional name. And I would like to hear from you, what do you see, how do you see the evolution of the American foreign policy towards Macedonia? Has really that much changed since 2008 in the approach that the United States have towards Macedonia?
Well, the best person to answer that one is right now Macedonia is fortunate that it has one of our very, very best ambassadors, Paul Wohlers, whom I know well. He is the latest in a line of ambassadors that have sustained a continuity in American policy towards Macedonia. The difference between today and 2001, 2002, which were the Bush years, of which I was a part, was you had an armed conflict. You had a crisis going on here, which required a lot of attention. It required American forces, and there were a lot of other things going on. All that's passed now. Macedonia enjoys, for better or for worse, enjoys a normal situation where there isn't an armed conflict in the neighborhood, and there is no prospect for an armed conflict. What you have is a normal, strong, friendly relationship between Washington, reflected in the fact that we've sent one of our, Washington was wise enough to send one of our best diplomats, who's already been here for more than 3 years. So I think there's a continuity, but it's also a reflection of, I use the word evolution. Nothing stays the same. As many times we'd like it, we'd like to be 18 years old forever. We do not want to be in a war forever. And so we're not 18. We've both grown up. It's a different period. There are different threats in different parts of the world. Happily, not here.
Mm. Yeah, coming to world threats, what is your take on the impact, the potential impact that ISIS might have on the Balkans? I mean, we are hearing of certain extremist individuals who have, from the Balkans, who have joined the ranks of ISIS.
I'm speaking now as a private American. I no longer work for the government, so I can have a personal opinion I couldn't have 10 years ago. One, the challenges that I think you refer to in the region, of persons from the region who have gone to Syria to fight with ISIS or ISIL, what you want to call it, it's not unique to Macedonia. The French probably have a bigger problem you do in terms of numbers, mm-hmm. and they've already experienced violence, inspired by the violence we've seen in Syria and other places. Likewise, we have also in the United States we have stopped and arrested young people trying to get to Syria. So this is one. This is a problem we share of how do you handle your young people in society? What is it about the families or society that caused them to think that there might be a good idea to actually go and risk their lives in a place like Syria? And then we have the problem of if they go and they live and they're not killed there, they come home. What happens then? How would you reintegrate them into society, which is an open society? Look, Kumano was a tolerant, diverse, and one of the most open cities in the Balkans. I've been in many cities in the Balkans. People get along with each other. It reminds me of the United States. That's why I feel at home here. So that's the challenge for the governments collectively is, and it comes down to the families. If a kid sees something on the internet, watches a YouTube video and says, I want to be that guy. And we had that during the years of the Kosovo conflict. You had 17-year-old boys, I'm sorry, are maybe the stupidest things that walk on the planet. Ask any 17-year-old girl what they think about that one. Ask their parents. But then they turn 21 one day, and they grow up and they realize they have responsibilities. That's going to be the challenge to society is, one, prevent them from going. And then if they do go, how do you get them back and reintegrate them? That's going to be a common challenge that we all face.
Yeah. Many European countries, including Balkan countries, have laws that actually condemn these activities as terrorist activities, and then it's practically impossible for these people, young people foremost, to come back to these countries. How can we reintegrate them?
I'll throw something out there, and I'm not sure I agree with it. I lived in Denmark for 3 years. Denmark has a different approach, where when these guys that went to Syria come back and openly come back, the Danes then work to, we need to get them off this path and get them into a Danish path, which is Denmark is also a very tolerant, very open, very accepting society. You can be almost anything you want to in Denmark without much judgment. It's an experiment. And Denmark is not Macedonia. Denmark is not the United States. But there's lessons, I think, to be learned using your religious leaders, your community leaders, using your parents and those who these people look up to. You want to keep them from going if you can. And the ones that are likely to commit a crime or be violent when they come back, then you have to keep track of them. But I'm more into 18-year-old kids will do what 18-year-old kids do. They can go be. They can become priests. They can become criminals. Mm-hmm. They can become business people. They can become professors. What understanding why people choose those paths, and then try to bring them back on from the path is we don't have answers on it, but it does require patience. It requires determination, but more importantly, it requires understanding and not just condemnation.
Thank you. When I was preparing for this interview, I asked some of my Facebook friends to jump in with ideas as to what to ask you.
But this is going to be interesting.
They're quite political, most of them, and I got two so far. First of all, you served as the High Representative in Bosnia and Herzegovina. When are we closing down that office?
We actually talked about that before the interview started, and I was picked by Patty Ashdown, who was the High Representative, and the American is almost always the Deputy High Representative. I was actually, Washington gave instructions to me as, you're going out there to close the office of the High Representative. That was 2005, and working with Patty Ashdown, we thought we'd be finished by 2007. We had a number of reforms, including police reform, that if we accomplish these, we can now hand the full sovereignty over to the Bosnian people of Bosnia and Herzegovina, and then, because running a country is not the job of outsiders. You know, we can do this, but we can't be on the inside. Because we are outsiders, we won't be there forever. So one of the things I researched was, what is the experience in other places where there's been an international mission of closing them? And I was a little bit surprised to find out we don't have a very good record of closing international missions. It doesn't happen. I mean, UNMIC is still going on in Kosovo. There's a UN mission peacekeeping force in Cyprus. This is like 35 years later. There's UN peacekeeping forces on the Golan Heights, you know, between Syria and Israel. And there's some scholars, academics, think that there becomes a dependency. It's easier for the local parties to depend on the outsiders and avoid making hard decisions and hard compromises. Mm. It's hard for people to say, okay, I've been married for 37 years. I know how to say I'm sorry. It's hard in international politics to say, moja greška.
Yeah.
It's because it's pride, it's honor, it's like, I can't do that. Well, I'm an American, I say I'm sorry all the time because we make lots of mistakes. But we're a big country, we can afford to make a mistake. We can afford to say we're sorry. Small countries, maybe it's harder to do that. So the Office of the High Representative is the international community that they're the ones that have to feel the comfort that if it leaves, the bad things won't happen. But you won't know until it leaves. So it's one of these dilemmas of, I personally think it should have closed a while ago. I think it's time for the people who live in Bosnia and Herzegovina to confront the reality that their future is their future, not my future. We had a different experience in Macedonia. I mean, the international community was here pretty heavy. There are no foreign troops in Macedonia anymore. Macedonia is 100% responsible for what happens here, not the outsiders. In Bosnia, we have responsibility. We share responsibility, but we shouldn't. So I can't predict when it's going to close. I thought it was going to close by 2007. I was wrong. Moja greška.
Yeah, happens. We're all human. The second question, much lighter than all of these. What are you taking as a gift back home to your family, to your friends? Are you bringing any memories from here?
I bring the memories. Mm. I'm probably also bringing about 5 kilograms more weight than I came. yesterday at the Švarkadiada, I remembered there are three things that are very dangerous for diplomats, and they all end in all. One is alcohol, and I will try to bring back some bottles of good, much better Macedonian wine. The second one is cholesterol, and that's not a gift. And I'll have to find out how to, because I was at the Švarkadiada, like, okay, Švarki, it's probably not good for you, but boy, does it taste good.
Yeah, it does.
it does taste good. The third opasnost is protocol, and I hope I will have shown that I'm a good friend here in Komanovo, but I also know I'm going to have good friends in Skopje, and in Tetovo and Bietola and Marievo and many other places who wonder why I didn't come down and visit them. And that's my bad. Moja greška, izvinjena vam se. That I didn't have enough time to come and see everybody. I hope I bring back a couple of some more Macedonian art. Macedonian art is something that art, if it touches you, it communicates across the ocean. And we have, I'm happy to say this one, we have a couple of paintings by Bujurski in our house.
That's excellent.
And that's how, and we have some icons as well, and we have other memories. So those are the things you wake up in the morning, you look at the wall, and I wake up in Macedonia. On good days. And then there are bad days where I wake up in Macedonia and I'm thinking, how are we going to solve this problem today? I remember, wait a minute, I don't have to. You actually solved the big problem. You have to solve the detail problems. Now you have the long-term problem. So how is Macedonia getting, how will it compete and develop in the world and still be Macedonia?
That's an excellent
Was that
message.
A good answer?
That's amazing. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you for talking to us so openly and being open to all of the questions that we came up with. And I hope that you do get a chance to visit all of your other friends in Macedonia very soon and visit us again.
Thank you. I hope to come back again. I hope to bring my wife back here. I made my wife move 23 times during our marriage. She never wants to move again. Her family lives in Finland. The other part of her family lives in Finland. And our son is moving to Texas, so we are pulled in many, many different directions. And as I say, the one thing you cannot make more of is time. Time is what it is. But the time I spent in Kumanovo is one I treasure forever. These 3 days I've spent in Kumanovo have been fantastic. Too, just to walk down the street, and there's the one guy yesterday at the near Vladika Yosef, he was working in the yard. He came over to me and goes, "Ambassador, says, I've seen you on television. I've never seen you in person." And I got this hug. And I said, okay, that's why I love Macedonia. It's the people. It's the spirit. So thank you, Ivana, for this time to talk to you. And to encourage my friends in Macedonia, says, this is a great country.
Work on it.
Make it better. Make it greater. It's a good country. The country's yours. And I'm proud that I was part of it. But I'm also more proud of the relationship between the United States and Macedonia. It's a good one. Your guys are with us everywhere. Afghanistan, Iraq. Hopefully you don't have to go to Syria. But I know you would be there and you would do a fine job if you were. I'm more interested in market, in business, and culture. That's where my world is. Mm. So thank you, Ivana.
Thank you.